When performing matrix multiplication in parallel, the GPU spawns threads for each output element. It's the programmer's job to work with these threads. An obvious way is to align the thread block's y-axis to the matrix rows and x-axis to the matrix columns. This way, the thread-to-element mapping is quite intuitive. However, another way is to do the opposite and map the y-axis to the columns and x-axis to rows. In this case, the thread-to-element mapping looks transposed, but it's valid and correct. The thing is that this program on my GPU took 3.6 seconds to finish, while the other one finished in under a second. That's over 4 times faster. Everything else between the two is exactly the same, so why such a big difference in performance? The answer lies in the GPU's global memory, or VRAM. Global memory in GPUs is implemented using DRAM technology, which means it has long latency and low bandwidth. Simply put, the data takes a long time to arrive at the processing units. To circumvent this, DRAM uses parallelism to increase the rate of data transfer. Each time a DRAM location is accessed, a range of consecutive locations are also accessed in parallel. This is known as DRAM bursts. Hardware does that by utilizing the warps. As a quick recap, whenever a GPU spawns threads in a block, they are grouped into units of 32. For a 2D block like this, threads are first linearized using a row major layout, and then first 32 threads are bundled into warp 0, and the next 32 make warp 1. It's crucial to remember that all threads in a warp are given one single instruction. So when this warp is given load instruction, the hardware checks whether all the threads in this warp are accessing consecutive elements, and if they are, the data can be transferred in parallel at much higher speeds. Let's now analyze the code and see how data is transferred to the CUDA cores. Keeping things simple, consider matrix multiplication involving two 4x4 matrices. To solve this in parallel, let's create a 4x4 grid of threads. In this case, the x-axis and the y-axis are mapped to the columns and rows respectively. So the thread-to-element mapping is quite straightforward. I know that a warp has 32 threads, but for simplicity, let's assume a warp of 4 threads. Another thing to remember is that the matrices A and B are stored in memory in a row major layout. For k is equal to 0, all threads in this warp access the same element of A and the first row of B. If you look carefully at the memory layout, all these threads are accessing the consecutive elements in the memory. So these memory accesses will be done in parallel at much higher speeds. The same thing goes for k is equal to 1, 2, and 3. In each iteration, the memory accesses are consecutive, and the final answer accumulates much faster as the data moves in parallel. At the end, the result is stored in matrix C. On the contrary, we can also map the x-axis to the rows and y-axis to the columns of C. Thread-to-element mapping is a bit interesting here, but nonetheless, we will get correct answers even if this type of mapping is used. The most important thing to note is that the warp is now aligned along the column of matrix C. So when we analyze the memory accesses in a single warp, in this case for each iteration of K, the same element of B is accessed, but a column of A is now needed to get the correct answer. These A values are not consecutive in memory, so it will take multiple load instructions to get these values to the cores. We got a 4.5x hit on performance because this happens multiple times and it's quite inefficient. It's interesting to see how a minor detail can affect the performance, and the knowledge of hardware was necessary to understand the reason. Okay, so we decided to go with the first implementation for the optimum memory transfer. When threads in a warp access consecutive elements, the memory's access is said to be coalesced. With optimized global memory transfer, the logical next step is to analyze the kernel function and see how far off this implementation is from my GPU's theoretical limit. In this code, the most important part in terms of execution time is the for loop that performs the dot product of the row of A and the column of B. In every iteration of this loop, two global memory accesses, 4 bytes each as it's a single precision float, are performed for one floating point multiplication and one floating point addition. Thus, the ratio of floating point operations performed to bytes accessed from global memory is 0.25. NVIDIA RTX 3090 has a peak memory bandwidth of around 936 GB per second. It means that the GPU can transfer 936 GB of data from global memory to compute units in a single second. As the kernel only performs 0.25 flop per byte, the global memory bandwidth limits the kernel to around 234 gigaflops. When I checked the GPU specifications, I found that RTX 3090 is capable of over 35,000 gigaflops. That means this version of parallel matrix multiplication is only using around 0.67% of the maximum compute capacity. This is a big problem. To solve this, we need to increase the number of operations performed per bytes accessed from the global memory. This is where we can use on-chip memory, which is the topic for the next video. Apart from these videos, I also publish detailed blog posts, which can be seen as video notes. If you want more details or some place to get a hint for the coming videos, please sign up. By the way, it's completely free. Anyways, thanks a lot for watching. Please let me know what you think in the comments, and I will see you next time.